Hi.
Hello.
Good afternoon.
Lovely to see you. How are you?
I'm good. How are you?
Excellent. Yeah, I'm so sorry. I got a message that you were going to be a bit late, so I was slightly late starting. Are you okay?
Yeah, I'm okay. Nice to meet you too.
Lovely to meet you. Where are you now?
Right now, I'm in Hanoi, the capital of Vietnam.
Oh, wonderful, wonderful. How long have you lived there?
I've been living here for about 5 years, for studying university.
Excellent. So I don't want to ask you too much about yourself yet, because I'm going to ask you that when we do the mock test.
Yeah.
But maybe just tell me a little bit about your plans for IELTS.
I want to achieve
You've frozen, I'm afraid.
Sorry, can you hear me?
That you, yeah, you froze. Can you go back to what you were saying about your IELTS?
I want to achieve a higher score while test, especially speaking.
And have you taken it before? You froze again. I'm so sorry. Have you taken it before?
Yes, several times, several times.
Okay, great. And what did you get?
The last time I got 8 for the overall score.
Wow, that's amazing.
Yeah.
That's an amazing score. And is it the speaking that you're worried about?
Yes, definitely.
So what did you get in the speaking?
The last time was 6.5.
Okay.
Yeah.
And do you need to get like 7 or 7.5 or?
7.5 or above.
Great. Well, it seems to me, I mean, you're a very confident speaker, and what do you think is holding you back from the 7.5?
Actually, I did achieve 7.5 once, but
Okay.
then it went down to 7 or sometime 6.5. I think maybe I don't have enough vocabulary or knowledge related to some different topics.
Interesting. Okay. All right. Fine. I just wanted to get a bit of background before we started. So what I'm going to do is really exactly like the real test. I mean, you're familiar with the real test anyway, but I'm just going to give you quite a thorough questioning to see if I can identify areas, specific areas that we can work on. So I've got something. I will share my screen with you when it comes to when it comes to the part where, let me just find it, sorry. Where is it? So when it comes to the part where I say part two and I give you a question, I'll share this with you. Okay, let's see if that works. Okay.
Have you sent me the message?
No, what I'll do is I'll share the screen
Oh
with
yeah.
you. I created a document for you just before the lesson, and it seems to have disappeared. Okay, well, I'll just use this one then. Strange. Oh, I'm really sorry. Let me just, I had it ready and it's gone.
Okay. It's okay. It takes your time.
Why is it gone? Okay, mock speaking test. Okay, well, I'll use this one. This is fine. And I'll create another one for you later. Okay. All right. So I'm using my phone as the timer, so don't worry if I stop you at any point or I seem to be pushing you. I'm just as they would in the normal test.
Yeah.
Okay, so I've got that ready. All right. So I'm just checking it's recording, so you've got a copy of it. Okay, let's go. So, good afternoon. My name is Fiona Wattam. Can you tell me your full name, please?
My full name is Trần Thị Mai Duyên.
Thank you. And what shall I call you?
You could call me Grace because it means Duyên in Vietnamese.
Thank you. And can you tell me where you're from, Grace?
I'm from Hải Dương, which is a small city in the north of Vietnam.
Thank you. Now, in this first part, I'm going to ask you some questions about yourself. First of all, do you work or are you a student?
Right now, I'm the last year university student in a foreign trade university in Vietnam, and my major is international business.
Thank you. And why did you choose this course?
Actually, I just chose this randomly because I heard one of my closest friends who had a sister, she's very successful and she's a successful entrepreneur. So I just thought that maybe I would follow in her footsteps and do something like her.
And do you work better in the morning or in the afternoon?
To be honest, I'm a night owl, so dragging myself out of bed in the morning is really challenging for me. So I tend to have a line until the noon, and then I stay up late, till the early hours to get my work done.
And don't worry, I'm just writing. You've got so many good things. I'm just trying to write things down at the same time. Okay, and do you get on well with your classmates on this course?
I have some of my close friends, but I feel like I don't get on well with most of my classmates. I think it's because my lifestyle is very different from theirs. I just come from a small village. They come from big cities like Hanoi or Cần Thơ, so I feel like they tend to lead an extravagant lifestyle. Whereas I just want to save up money for my future.
Thank you. And what do you think you'll do when the course finishes?
To be honest with you, though I chose international business, but actually right now I spend so much money and time on learning English and sharpening my English skills. And I don't take my studies at university seriously right now.
Thank you. Okay, now remember in the real test, they either ask you about what you do or about your home, but I'm going to ask both anyway, so I can just get a good idea of how you're answering both questions. Okay, so the examiner chooses either your job, your studies, or your home. So I'm going to ask you some questions now about your home. Do you live in a house or an apartment?
I've just moved into an 8-story apartment just 7 months ago. I shared with one of my friends in the universities. It has a nice view with a lot of trees and even skyscrapers around it.
What's your favorite room?
Because I live in a studio apartment, so I have just one room. So that's definitely the room where I do everything from eating and learning or things like that. But if you want to talk about the house in my hometown, definitely is the kitchen. where my mother and I usually cook dishes, and I inherit a lot of interesting recipes from her there.
Thank you. And is it a good place to bring up children, or is it a good place for families?
Generally, it's quite safe and secure because there isn't, any crimes there. There are also a lot of playgrounds and green spaces, which is very good for children to play out and being surrounded by nature. I think so.
Thank you. And do you think you'll stay there for a long time?
No, because I think it's quite old-fashioned for a young mind like me, because I want to throw myself into a new environment, like big city, to challenge myself and develop myself more.
Thank you. All right, let's talk now about public transport. What kinds of public transport do they have in your country?
There are quite a few means of public transportation in my country. We have, of course, buses, and recently they've just built some metro lines. Also, we have train or things like that. But I think the public network, the public transportation network is not it's not very effective. So that's the reason why a lot of people still choose their private vehicle rather than public transportation.
What's your favorite type of public transport?
Definitely bus. I usually take the bus to go to school. Partially because it's quite reasonable, and also I haven't had a driving license, so I had to use it.
And what do you do when you're traveling on public transport?
Most of the time, I just enjoy looking at the streets and people around, but sometimes. Actually, I avoid reading on the bus, while moving because it can makes me feel, car sick,
And you kind of answered this, but I'm going to ask you anyway. But how could public transport in your country be improved?
I think the first thing they should improve is they need to create a designated lane for only the bus, because actually we have, but a lot of drivers or motorists, they just blend the lane to the lane of the bus. So that's the reason why, as I said, it's not very effective.
Thank you. All right. Now I'm going to give you a topic and I'd like you to talk about it for 1 to 2 minutes. Before you talk about it, you'll have 1 minute to think about what you're going to say. You can make some notes if you wish. Do you understand?
Yeah, I understand.
All right. So I'll copy and paste it if you want into the chat, but I'll share my screen as well, whatever's easier for you. So, I'd like you to describe an open air or street market which you enjoyed visiting. All right. Remember, you have 1 to 2 minutes for this, so don't worry if I stop you. Can you start speaking now, please?
Let me take you back to 4 years ago when I had a trip to Sapa with some of my friends in my English class and also some of my foreign friends. Actually, Sapa is a very famous tourist attraction in Vietnam, and it has quite a reputation for street markets, where people can experience a lot of local cuisine and traditional clothes, in remote areas. And it's definitely a good chance for me to experience everything, and it's really lived up to its reputation. In Sapa, we can find a wide range of products. From like I said, local food, costumes, and some kind of cleaning products, or some stores, shop stores, souvenirs, and things like that. And it has different apartments, so it's very big. I remember on that day I went with my friend called Georgia. She wanted to buy a costume, of an ethnicity minority. And when she walked past through a store and she asked for a costume, then I felt like the shop owners tried to, make her buy something and, with a very expensive cost. And at that time, I realized that how, bargaining is such a great skill to have for that moment, because the shop owners said they cost 500 Vietnam dongs, which is prohibitively expensive, very unreasonable. And my friend called Hui. She helped my foreign friend to buy the costume, which is half the price, and with some skills, like she pretended to go through the store and find a store new, but then the shop owners tried to weighted bags.
Thank you. I did let you go more than 2 minutes just so I could hear a bit more, but that's lovely. Thank you. And do you think you'll go to this market again soon?
Yes, if the travel restrictions are removed, definitely.
Thank you. Lovely, thank you. Now, we've been talking about an open air street market that you visited, and I'd like to ask you some more questions related to this. First of all, do people in your country enjoy going to open markets? Do people in your country enjoy going to open markets?
To my mind, going to street markets is still a big part of our culture. Like in my hometown, people still mainly go to street market to buy things rather than supermarkets. But this is not the case for people living in the city, because we have shopping centers where everything is clearly originated from somewhere.
And do you think young people feel the same about shopping at markets as older people?
I think young people can't feel the beauty of going to the street market as older people, because They all like to talk with the shop owners and bargain, which is like one of the most characteristics of going to a street market. But youngsters tend to buy things in convenience stores or supermarkets where everything where the price is tagged clearly, and they don't have to do anything rather than just buy it.
Do you think there's a risk that we will lose these kind of old-fashioned outdoor markets? Do you think they'll be completely replaced by supermarkets?
It seems to me that people, especially people in the countryside, still go to the open-air markets. Even now, there are lots of supermarkets or even shopping centers sprouting up a lot of places. Because, as I said, it just boils down to the habit of enjoying talking to shop owners or just haggling and things like that. It's like an art, even an art of bargaining, and also one of the characteristic of Vietnamese culture.
Okay, let's talk a little bit about advertising now. How does advertising influence what people choose to buy?
Nowadays, advertising is unavoidable, and I think it tends to manipulate consumers into buying something even when they don't really need it. Like some beauty products. Advertisers tend to exaggerate the efficiency of them and push the especially teenagers or girls who are obsessed about their appearance to buy things. And also they tend to use celebrity endorsement to win the trust from other people.
What kind of regulations are in place to prevent these manufacturers making these maybe false claims about their products?
Well, it's really hard to say exactly because I think social media is a good place for seller to advertise their products, but also it's a place where people can be misled about some, even they when they show some certificate, but it can definitely be forged. So maybe Facebook or Instagram should have some policy to censor or some kind of document, official document for the sellers to have. So if they meet all the requirements, they can sell their products.
Do you think people are becoming maybe more aware that they're being sold to? They're more aware of what the tricks are these days?
Yes, because I think it's available in everywhere. We have some articles talking about that, but it actually comes from the need. If they need it, even they know that it's wrong, but they want to have it, they still do it. And as I said, because celebrity endorsement is a very effective tool for advertiser. So if you are a big fan of a celebrity, you tend to copy their lifestyle and do everything they use in their life.
So is the blame really on the buyer rather than the seller? Should the buyer just be more careful about how they spend their money?
I think so. Everyone should be aware of some problems related to the idea that if they buy too many things, like let's take environmental issues for example. If you own a lot of things like plastic bags or things like that, it means you pollute the environment with more waste. So I think it's people just change their behavior when there's some negative effect on directly on their lives.
And do you think shopping habits are likely to change in the future?
I think so because after COVID, I think shopping habits have changed dramatically because right now, like myself and most of my friends, we do shopping on online shopping much more frequently than we used to. So I think even now when you scroll through the new feed, people tend to sell everything online, so maybe consumers tend to get used to online shopping without too much reservation like they used to have before.
And what are the effects on the environment, good or bad, of so many people shopping online rather than going physically to the shops?
Shopping online can be bad because, you know, when you some people can still think is, you know, some people still are quite skeptical about buying things online, but I think it can help them save time and also the money consumed for gas or so for petrol and things like that, because one shipper can do that for a lot of people at the same time instead of each one go to the shop. So I think it can, you know, to a small extent can help to you know, reduce the carbon footprint of each person.
So overall, would you say online shopping is a good thing or a bad thing?
I think it's a good thing. It's a trend and it's a good thing. And it will still continue in the future. I believe so.
Thank you. That's the end of the speaking test. Okay, my goodness, Grace, I am struggling here to try and find something useful that I can tell you to improve your score. I think you're absolutely amazing. Don't know why you're not getting 7.5 every time. You know, it often depends on a subjective judgment of the examiner on the day, if they're tired, if whatever the question is, but you are clearly a 7.5 easily.
Thank
You know,
you.
and I'll go through the criteria with you. The things that I've written are, I don't think they're going to make the difference between a band score. I've got a few things I felt could, but whether, you know, it's the question on the day or whether that's your normal style, we'll talk about that in a minute. How did you feel?
I think I still struggle to speak in part two. I feel there's a lot of things in my mind and I don't control the tense exactly. I think that's
Okay, yeah, it's interesting. Some people say part two is the most important part. I tend to think part three is most important because that's where you're dealing with unexpected questions and really showing, you know, how you can deal with it. I think part two possibly was your weaker area, but you brought it back in part three. You kind of compensated for it. But maybe we want to just be completely consistent that every part of the test you're showing the examiner. But the only thing really in part two, I thought you hesitated a bit more than you did in part one. Part one was entirely confident and there was no hesitation. But it would be interesting if you look back at the part two, and I wonder if that hesitation possibly is what's bringing your score down a bit. In part three, there wasn't so much of that, apart from right at the end, when I kind of said, "Do you think shopping online in terms of the environment. And you started by saying, well, shopping online can be bad because some people think, I mean, well, some people, you did start that sentence about four times, but again, that's quite a natural thing to do in conversation, isn't it? But whether that hesitation is counting against you on the day, I don't know. Okay, so let's just have a quick look. Some of the things I noticed. Well, first of all, your vocabulary is excellent. You know, it's band eight vocabulary. So you used idioms like in a way that wasn't somebody trying to show off. Oh, look at this idiom I know. Lots of people do that, you know. It's not my cup of tea. Sounds very unnatural, but yours were very natural right from the start. I wanted to follow in her footsteps. I'm a night owl. Oh, I could have written lots of them. You said right at the end, you said there's lots of shops sprouting up, but it all boils down to all of that language is like a, consistently a band eight. No doubt about it in terms of vocabulary. I mean, one thing people tend to use quite formal vocabulary. And like you said, I said, do you think you'll go to the shop again? And you said, not until the travel restrictions are removed. Now, is that active or passive removed? And until the
I think
whole.
it's passive.
Yeah. So although in you know, formal task two writing, I would recommend it. Possibly in speaking, you might say something more like until they get rid of the until they get rid of the travel restrictions.
Oh, yeah.
You know, but I'm really looking for things now that I don't want to confuse you and say, oh, don't use that and use this, or you'll get really confused. But there is that element of kind of more natural language. So I've made a note where you said, you know, we have what was it about the driver's license? Oh, about the transport. I said, what kind of transport you said, and you said we have buses, for example. You know, more natural way might be we've got buses, we've got trains, really small things. And you've got a lovely pronunciation, really nice, and lots of all the pronunciation features of fast connected fluent speech. Most of the time, you use contractions like I'm a night owl again. You speak quite specifically, so you might say like I want to, whereas fast speech might be what I want.
Yeah.
You know, I want to go. I want. I want.
Yeah.
When we talked about after your studies.
Yeah.
Again, it's not something that's going to really make a difference, but there are these features like I'm gonna, I wanna, I have to, might just hit it more to the eight than the seven, but it's really borderline. What else? What else? What else? What else? Yeah, I mean, even like, so you said about the clothes in the market being your friend was going to pay $500, and you said this would be prohibitively expensive. I mean, it's a fantastic word. In task two, it's fantastic, you know.
Thank you.
But again, the natural band aid thing might be, you know, it was such a rip-off, or, you know, it costs a fortune, or
Oh,
just that kind of idiomatic. Possibly a bit more idiomatic language instead of the formal choices, possibly. But I loved the way that you just threw in these very natural expressions. Like I said, why did you choose this subject? And you said, oh, I chose it quite randomly. You know, it's very natural way of throwing things in like that. Okay, one or two pronunciation things. Tell me again the idiom that you used for somebody who likes working at night.
Night owl.
Okay, sometimes with those words, you tended to stress the second. You said I'm a night owl. Stress on the second one, but the stress is on the first one. I'm a night owl. Little things like that. Where do children play?
Playground.
The playground. Yeah. So
Playground.
you said playground. One or two, but it doesn't affect understanding or intelligibility, so it still wouldn't bring you down from an eight. And you've got a slight ch sound that sounds a little bit like ch sometimes. Let me give you an example. Okay, let's say I want to.
I want to.
There's a little bit of I want to, a little slight A.
The sound T and ch,
A
right?
little bit sometimes, which made occasionally I had to think, what did she just say with that word? But it's such a minor thing. And a slightly with a per and the b once or twice. So you said it's a big part of my life, or a pip pip per and a b, a big part. Say a big part.
Big part.
Yeah, it's just like a tongue twister anyway. Yeah. Right, definitely twice. So that's definitely something in terms of grammar now. I'll say it and you correct it. So it can makes me feel sick.
Making me feel sick. It can make me feel sick.
So either it makes me feel sick, or it can make me.
It can make me feel sick.
Perfect. And like right at the end then, you said it can helps to reduce carbon footprint.
Oh yes. When we use, sometimes I feel like I was torn between can, the more verb and verbs, and it's confused.
So definitely, because it came up twice, I think that could be a small grammar thing. Possibly would bring you down to a seven, because it's quite a basic rule, I guess. And because it happened more than once, they wouldn't just say, oh, that was just a slip of the tongue. They might say, oh, yeah, well, definitely that's a grammar issue. So that possibly would be the seven. And that could be enough to possibly keep you at 7.5 rather than eight. There were a few other ones, but I don't think they're systematic errors. I don't think your grammar is at fault. I think it was just a spoken mistake. So, for example, listen to what I say now. There isn't any crimes.
There aren't any crimes.
Yeah. But again, crime can be uncountable too. So maybe you were thinking, well, there isn't any crime. And your brain was just thinking ahead and you thought, okay, lots of crimes. There's such small areas. You said, when you talked about, I think you said, I inherit recipes from my mum, I think. But you were talking about the past tense. So how would you say inherit?
I've inherited.
Inherited, yeah. Small thing with the past tense. And you when we talked about driving, you said, I haven't had a driver's license. What do you think about that? I haven't had a driver's license.
Driving license, right? Or
It's more with
driver
the
license?
tense. It's with a tense.
I don't have. I don't have.
Perfect. So Either I don't have, which is fine, present simple, or I haven't got. So, which one of those is less formal?
Less formal is haven't got.
Haven't got. Perfect. Yes. So remember we said about making it kind of natural. So you said before we have, and we have lots of buses, and I thought maybe better to say we've got, and it's the same here. Tell me now. Tell me about, can you drive?
I haven't got a driver license.
Perfect. I think drivers and driving is both okay, actually. I think that's not a mistake. So yeah, I haven't got a driver's license. I haven't got a driving license. Yeah. Great. Okay, what else? I think that's it. Whenever I do the part two, I choose this one because people often go wrong and they end up just talking too much in the present simple, and they say, oh, it sells this, it sells this, it sells this. And I think there was a point where you said, oh, you know, it sells cleaning products, it sells souvenirs, where you weren't showing off the range of your language because you were maybe too closely looking at the question. Lots of people do that. They think they see the bullet points. I mean, do you focus on the bullet points, or do you try to go a little off that strict instruction?
Actually, I went with bullet points.
But you feel confident that you don't have to stick to those bullet points, do you?
Yes,
Yeah.
I think it's because I haven't practiced part two for a long time. Maybe
Okay.
that's the reason why right now I struggle with it, but life. 1 year ago, I practiced intensively speaking, and I did a lot of part two, and even I can brainstorm everything in my mind rather than writing it, and I can still, talk with my flow. But now I think I just struggle with the idea, like I'm afraid of going off topic or things like that.
Okay, all right, because normally when I do task two speaking with my members academy, I want them to finish because it's like it kind of gets quite painful. But with you, it was very easy to listen to you, and you know, I let you speak for much longer. You don't struggle at all with speaking for 2 minutes. But just in terms of how you can then boost it a bit. I always recommend people go into a kind of storytelling mode. And you kind of did. You talked about, oh, I remember going there. Did you at the end? You talked about a story about when you went there.
Yes, but I tried storytelling, but I think I didn't succeed in doing that.
It kind of started, but it didn't kind of get going. I mean, it's
Yeah.
difficult because I was writing at the same time, but I thought, oh, great, she's going to do the storytelling now. And so I kind of recommend that my students kind of spend 1 minute building up this background story. You know, oh, I remember going there when I was a child, and you know, I'd never been there before, so my mum took me and she told me to blah blah blah. This kind of story, it extends your range a bit, you know, because you might be using reported speech or what somebody said to you, or
Yeah.
you know, gives you past perfect. And I'd been waiting there for ages and I couldn't remember where, blah blah blah. And that is something you could try building in to it. And I tell everybody, just ignore the bullet points, try not to get too restricted by them. You know, the bullet points are really for the weaker students who struggle to think of something to say, but you're not that candidate. So as long as you've talked about the market and then go into this story like scenario that I think always boosts people's range so the examiner can give them a range for accurate past tenses and so on.
Yes, I think in part two is where we can use different tenses easily more than part one and part three.
Exactly, because part three is so opinion based, and again, you had this language re reduce the carbon footprint. You had all of that language, but it's not showing any tenses. It's showing great vocabulary range, but part two is that the range of grammar, definitely. Okay, let me just look. I'm just gonna look at the band descriptors. I mean, maybe you could tell me where do you think it's. I mean, you know these, don't you? You've had a look at them before. Speaking. Sorry, I just come to the notebook. Hang on. Band descriptors. Okay. I mean, they're not very clear, and especially for vocabulary, they're pretty useless in terms of finding exactly where you are on them. But let's have a look at them together.
Yes.
Let's focus on the fluency and coherence. So I'm looking between a 7 and 8. If I was an examiner, because examiners tend not to look at 9, I'm not saying you're not 9, but they tend to look between 7 and 8. So we've got to decide fluently with only occasional repetition or self-correction. Hesitation is content related. Or speaks at length without noticeable effort or loss of coherence. May demonstrate language-related hesitation. Some repetition. So that's what the examiner's got to decide, is whether you were just speaking completely fluently at length or whether there was some hesitation, really. And what was that hesitation about ideas or was it about language? And that's what the examiner has to decide. What do you think?
I think I still have hesitation related to language and both language and idea.
Okay. Yeah. I think on a good day, you could be an 8, but I think there was that hesitation, possibly the part two where we need to focus. So that might bring you down to 7. Let's look at lexical resource. So either wide, readily, and flexibly can provide precise meaning, and this one less common. So I would go for 8 very clearly there, but I'm wondering if the hesitation might bring you down there. You've got the precise meanings, but you do tend to have to think about it. I still would go 8 there because here, if you go to 7, it says just some vocabulary, and I think you've got more than some. I think you use that skillfully. Definitely an 8, but the examiner would have to think, okay, she's got that. Has she got that? I think yes, flexibly to convey precise meaning. Has she got the paraphrase? Do you know what that is, paraphrase?
Yes, when we say things in different ways.
Exactly. And so I think possibly some of the hesitation, it comes across as if you're trying to think of saying it in a different way. And that makes you hesitate. And it's almost like if you stuck with the first option, the first thing you were thinking about, and stuck with it, then you'd hit 8 for everything. I think just once or twice you started to say something and you decided to say it in a different way, which is good because you paraphrase effectively. But if that causes hesitation, then it'll bring you down to 7. Okay. Grammatical range and accuracy, let's have a look. So wide range, flexibly, majority error-free, I would say definitely. Occasional, very occasional. And they have to decide if the errors were systematic, means it's you're making grammar mistakes, that's 7, or if it was just a slip of the tongue. So I think for most of yours, they would decide they were just, you know, crimes, you know, is the kind of native speaker error. Driving license, native speaker error, you know, slips. So you're there almost. But then the can, they might think, oh, that's a basic grammar mistake.
Yeah.
But you fix that now, so you don't have to worry. Range of complex structures. I think yes, but possibly not giving yourself the best chance to show it. I think you've got that ability, just needing to show it a bit more in that part two.
Yeah, I think so.
But you know, there's elements of a 9 there, I think. So very strong, I think, in grammar. Pronunciation, now this is where they're very wishy-washy, unclear about what is a band 9, what's a band 8. So if we look at the band 8, I think you do have a wide range. Flexible use, occasional lapses. You see, that could be just once or twice where the stress was on the wrong word, once or twice. Still wouldn't keep you from 7. Easy to understand, 100%. Accent, minimal or no effect, I would say. You know, even there, effortless to understand. So what would bring you down to 7? It's not clear, according to these band descriptors, but, you know, definitely not a 6. Don't think there's mispronunciation of individual words, reduces clarity, no. So clearly not a 6, clearly a 7, even possibly an 8. And what did we say that you could do to keep that at an 8? Possibly, what did we say? Possibly that instead of the we have, doing the we've got, or I don't have, or I haven't got, or I want to becomes I wanna.
Wanna.
I mean, don't force yourself to say that, but it's just that fast speech features, those pronunciation features. But your intonation is lovely. You're very easy to listen to. So I would probably go with 8 for pronunciation, 8 for grammar. I want to give you 8 there, and possibly then the 7 might bring you there, possibly the hesitation. So I can see no reason why you're not consistently getting 7.5. apart from the question or the examiner, but definitely to keep you at 8, it's part two and the hesitation or the paraphrasing that possibly needs work. I mean, try practicing those part twos, recording yourself, and every time you want to hesitate, just keep going. just keep going and finish what you were going to say. And even if you reverse and say, oh, what I mean is.
Yeah, what I mean is.
That's better than keep trying to start again, you know?
Yeah, I understand.
But I think you're a very, very strong candidate. When are you taking the next test?
I plan to take the next IELTS test in June. Yeah.
Okay, oh,
Yeah.
you've got time. You've got a few weeks to develop it then.
Yeah.
Great. Do you have any questions for me?
Actually, I still wonder about my pronunciation because I think my intonation is not very good, and I think I need to improve more on this area, my intonation.
I think your intonation is fine. I think it's just the hesitation that is causing problems with intonation because every time you're starting a sentence, you're starting it again, so it doesn't have the flow that,
Yeah.
but when you're in your flow, I don't think the intonation is an issue. Intonation is extremely hard to change. It's almost, people argue it's unteachable. So I wouldn't try to do anything dramatic with your intonation. It's fine. It's fine. I work with people on intonation and I wouldn't say you need to do that. But if it's the fluency that's causing this kind of interruption, that I think that will help then with your intonation.
Yeah. I think the reason why I got 6.5 the last time, maybe because I don't know why, but today I feel quite comfortable speaking with
Okay.
you. But on some other days I felt very stressed, and whenever I'm nervous, I stutter.
Okay.
Yeah, I used to stutter a lot even in my mother tongue, but actually I take advantage of speaking IELTS to improve my public speaking, and I think it's improved a lot.
It's great. Yeah, you'd never know. Yeah. Do you speak English on a kind of daily basis to make make yourself feel a bit more kind of as if you're not always being tested? I mean, do you feel, is there somebody you can chat to that you can just chat naturally with?
Yes, I have, and right now I'm a TA for an English center.
Oh,
Just
great.
want to make sure my English isn't rusty, will not rusty, because actually right now I'm taking a course on public speaking.
Great.
Yeah, because I used to so nervous whenever I strike up a conversation with a stranger. But right today, I don't know, I feel really comfortable speaking with you.
Well, that's great. I mean, nerves, they're always an issue, and I've done lots of research on how to stop nerves, and I saw something the other day, and it's supposed to be the simplest strategy, which is you go into the speaking and in your head you're saying, I'm so excited to be doing this, and that mentally turns it from a test into something enjoyable. And in your head say, so excited to be speaking to this person today, and it makes you relax. I don't know if it's worth a try.
It's a good technique because I normally tend to be quite critical about myself. Like I focus too much on my mistakes and I think I'm not good enough. But right now I think I should be more confident and
I think you should, yeah.
practice more. Yeah, practice more to improve
Yeah.
myself.
Do that 2 minutes and record yourself.
Yeah.
See how it sounds to you. Yeah. Okay. All right. So thank you. It's been so nice to meet you today. I'm going to send you this as a recording so you can keep it. And in that email, I'll send you a kind of summary of what the action points and stuff like that. But if you have any questions, don't hesitate. You've got my email. If there's anything you think of later, then don't hesitate to ask. Is that
Yeah.
okay?
Yeah, it's okay.
Great.
Thank you.
Well, have a lovely day and let me know how it goes.
Yeah, I actually have a question. Where do you come from?
I'm from Wales.
You're in English.
So in the UK, I
Yeah,
have quite,
I can notice that from your accent. Yeah,
my
it's
sister.
lovely. I
Yours
love
is too. You've got a lovely accent. You'll do
it. Thank
really
you.
well. I'm sure you'll do really well.
Yeah, thank you so much for your advice.
Okay. Bye, Grace. Nice chatting to you.
Bye. Have a nice day.
Too. Bye bye.
Bye.